discussion, lecture. What's the significance of Tom's Diner in your everyday life? You might not ever have heard it, but why is it significant? Okay, for you guys. So you have to find this out. Why is it significant for the user experience? Why do we care? You don't need to, by the way, one thing, if you're going to write notes, writing notes is good, not so that you remember stuff, but so you understand what I'm saying now. However, in these notes, you'll also find everything you need to know about Tom's Diner, etc. Okay? So you don't need to write them correctly. And you'll see that at the bottom of each side, there's a thing. Note 17. This is a note. The lots of this stuff, that's where it's found in the notes. Okay, so if you go to page 17, you'll see still these questions in Tom's Diner. Okay, so, what properties of Tom's Diner makes it so significant? So has anybody heard Tom's Diner at all? Has anybody actually listened to Suzanne Baker? And there's some far-thinking, excellent, musically minded people in here, are you all heathens? You know, nobody's ever heard of Tom's Diner. Jesus, God, okay, Tom's Diner, it's very good. Anyway, there's a reason why it's significant to you guys. What properties makes Tom's Diner so significant? Okay. And why does this significance in three, why does it make it good science? So who knows anything about science? You're doing computer science or something like this. Okay? What's the main thing about science? What's its main... facts. The scientific method. Okay, guys, you need to come in and squeeze in. And if you can't squeeze in... Oh, there's some seats here. That's okay. Squeeze, squish it up, squeeze it up, everybody. You don't have to move them. Or crawl over them, climb over the desk, do whatever you need. Job's good. Okay. This is your penalty for coming in late. Alright, so, science. Scientific method, what's one of the main tenets of the scientific method?
Test things.
Testability. And once you've tested it, what's the other thing where we can say that something, is something in science, so are you signed up for this course? Or are you just randomly, are you signed up for this course?
No.
You can come in if you want. Okay. Testability. What else?
Results,
okay. That's something that's produced from science. But the scientific method. What are we trying to do? Are we trying to prove something's right or prove it's wrong? Pardon? Prove it's right.
That's the wrong kind of question, isn't it?
It
depends what the hypothesis is, but what is a good solid science? Are you trying to prove something's right or wrong? We say right down here?
Wrong.
Yes, we're trying to refute the hypothesis. Everything is refutation. We're trying to disprove it. Because in empirical work, not theoretical work, but empirical work, there's never 100%. There's never a scientific proof in empirical work. Okay? The empirical work that you're going to do, experimental work that you're going to do here in the user experience, there's never 100% proof. It's all statistical confidence. Okay? So you have to work. Okay, so we can prove something is incorrect because we only need one instance of something to be wrong. But we can't prove stuff is correct because we might never find that one instance. Yeah, there's no room, I'm afraid, it's just a bit difficult to go. Okay. So, logistics of the course. 21 teaching sessions over these 2-hour periods. Some of these teaching sessions you're going to be doing slightly different things in. There's not going to be coursework. There's not going to be experimental work in the labs or that kind of thing, because you've got your third year projects to do, so that's not something we want to do. However, we should be having some guest lectures, so there'll be a guest lecture on the 20th of March from the BBC, Research and Development, who do user experience. They've got a reasonably big UXT there. And so they'll be coming down to talk to you about what it's really like in real life. There should also be, although ThoughtWorks have not got back to me yet, ThoughtWorks are coming down to do a user experience discussion about how UX fits into the agile development process and software engineering lifecycle, which we're going to touch on. If I can get Toby to give us the cash again, then we're going, as per last year, to the Manchester City Art Gallery. So you're going to look at aesthetics and understand how aesthetics in your software design matches the aesthetics of art, sculpture, that kind of thing. So these are the kind of things you're going to be doing. This is the kind of course you're going to be doing. Now, we're going to have three discussions, and these three discussions are going to be part of the coursework. Now, last year they said we want more people to come and talk to us, so we've increased that. Last year they said we want less coursework, so we've decreased that. Okay, so you've got one less bit of coursework, but it still represents 30% of your total mark. Okay. Now, this coursework, the first one, is due next Wednesday. So you're going to read a paper. It's a really interesting paper about what user experience really is. Okay? And it's all there. It'll be referenced from your notes. You can get a free download from it. It's in the ACM Digital Library. Something else you're going to learn. Unfortunately, yes. Okay, so that's what I'm expecting. We're going to get this bit of coursework done for a number of reasons, but in real life, the reason why we're expected to summarise the important parts of what you think are important after you've read it is because that's what's expected in UX work. You'll expect to take up something about human interaction that you don't really understand directly. You have to read something and prepare a briefing with somebody. They do it at the BBC all the time. Okay, so if you can't digest just one simple paper and give 250 succinct words on it, then that's something that you need to work on. Okay, so it's what we're doing. It's what we do a lot in user experience. It's what happens a lot in the industry in user experience. The 250 words. Why am I choosing 250 words?
Length of an abstract.
Length of an abstract. Okay, so 250 words is about the average length of a standard abstract for a research paper. And 250 words is what's the industry standard for this kind of stuff. So when your managers will say, give me 250 words on something, on this. Read this and give me 250 words of the relevant parts. Not what it is, but what's the important bit. Okay. Okay. As I've said, I consider you all adults. You don't need to come if you don't feel that you need to. All these things are videoed, you can watch them online if you think you don't need to ask any questions, or you've got the notes, or you blah, 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 whatever. Okay, that's okay. However, there is a direct correlation between your attendance and your exam result. Okay? And I do the stats on this, so there is. Okay, so there's a direct correlation. The people who attend get more than the average. Yeah? So if you attend, you're going to get better exam results. Mainly because you're sat here making notes aren't necessarily great for later, but they're good for now. Okay? I'll let you understand what you're doing now, that's why we make notes. Alright, so what's the syllabus? What's going to happen? As I say, all this is in your works over here, it's on syllabus, page 219 in your appendices if you really care about it. Everything is wrong. So the next lecture we're going to do in a moment, at 11 o'clock, is going to be called Everything is Wrong. Anybody heard of Ted Nelson? Ah, dude, Ted Nelson. Anybody else heard of Ted Nelson? Anybody heard of, what's that thing now? Hypertext. Anybody heard of hypertext? Okay, good, because he invented that. So there you are. So good, you'll learn about a bit more about Ted Nelson and why he thinks that everything's wrong. And why everything being wrong, or your conceptions of everything being wrong, is a good idea. That's a good way to be critical. It's what you're going to need to do in user experience work, because everything is about critique. Okay, so you're going to need to be critical of everything. You think you've got a good interface, but actually, it's crap. And the only reason you can tell that is because you have to, the user experience person come in, and they will tell you what people think of it. Okay, and they have to, and that means you have to be critical. Okay, UX the ghost. So that's going to be next week, after you've read your user experience paper. And the reason why I call it UX the Ghost is because really, at this point, it's really nice because nobody really knows. So there's lots of different definitions of what user experience is, and we'll get onto those different definitions, they're in your appendices, and we'll also get into why I've got a definition and why I'm obviously right. Okay, so that's what we'll do there. Building under the umbrella. So here we're going to talk about agile. Okay, so who's done agile development, software engineering, who's taking? Okay, so some people. So you know, this isn't a prerequisite directly for this course, but we'll talk about why agile development is a good idea, is a good way of going about user experience, especially when we come into prototyping applications, okay, interfaces, that kind of thing. Okay, it's complicated. Yes, it's very complicated. And so the thing that we want to talk to you about in this lecture is about the complex nature of people's interactions, okay, their perception, their neurochemistry, how it all fits together. Okay, so that's why people are just inherently complicated. And that's why this is a really interesting but difficult topic, because you know, it's not like a computer where you can predict what you're going to get out, really. You know, this is real world stuff. So you can't predict what you're going to get out. It depends on lots of stuff, and you'll see this in the user experience, conceptions of user experience. People say that, you know, experiments are valid even if theory exists for that moment in time, because people like the feeling different. So they might like something or dislike something. You've got to take that into account based on how they're feeling. And it's also interesting because later on we're going to talk about how to manipulate. Well, that's not called manipulation. Let's call it something else. But we're going to talk about how to manipulate those emotions and those feelings so that you get a better reaction in your software interface, okay, to your software interface. Because what you'll find is that people's perception is far more strong than reality. So you might have an excellent interface, but if people's perceptions of that interface are bad, then you're not going to have a good, they're not going to have a good user interface, user interaction experience. Okay? If their perceptions of that interface are really great, even though it might not be the best, they're really going to enjoy it. Strange, but it's true. Okay, how actual understanding, how do we model this stuff, and how do we then communicate that stuff through to software engineers? So who's known the personas or scenarios? It's a software engineering technique, no? Yes? A few people? Okay, so we're going to look at personas and scenarios a bit more. I'm going to tell you what kind of work you need to do over a period of maybe 6 weeks, 6 months, or a year. I'm going to tell you what, if you've got that length of time, I'm going to tell you what kinds of observational techniques or what kind of investigative techniques you can use to actually make sure you understand what's going on with people. Yeah? What people want. Generally, we want to understand what is it that people want and how can we communicate those wants. And don't use a napkin. Well, here we do a bit of UML, nothing drastic. How many people have seen UML? Yeah, okay, so enough. Okay, so we're going to do a little bit of UML there, but nothing that's kind of culturally remarkable. Yeah, it's to try and let you understand the kind of techniques. The reason why this course is called UX from 30,000 feet is because it's exactly that. It's a very, very broad overview of the entire landscape. And so what I give you at the end of each of the chapters here is some self-assessment questions, but also further reading. So the idea is when you get out into the world and somebody starts using some terms to you, you'll kind of understand the terms, be able to look at them in the book, and then go deeper down, drill down into the further reading if you really need to understand the techniques. Yeah? So that's why it's this kind of very high-level stuff. I could spend an entire course unit, probably more, on each one of these topics. In fact, there are entire course units on each of these topics at various other places. Yeah? So if you were doing an HCI degree from scratch, doing each one of these, this would be a 24-hour lecture course each one. Okay, so, effectiveness. So, effective use is more about accessibility, so it's kind of good best practice for making sure your stuff can be used effectively. Efficient is usability. Has anybody done usability before? Heard of usability? Yeah, okay. So we've got some usability techniques. Some of them are quite qualitative. Do you know what qualitative kind of work is? Yeah?
Is it not sort of asking questions rather than doing a survey?
That's right, asking questions. So if it's qualitative, you probably can't get any statistical data from it. And it's quantitative if you can. So quantitative work might be, you might measure I don't know, you might measure an eye tracking time to first fixation. So you might see how long it takes for somebody to look at a certain position on the screen. And you'd be able to measure that and begin to get an average over people. Yeah? Okay. Emotional use. Okay, so emotional use is more about what is, has anybody called a heard of affective computing? Affective computing. No? Okay, so affective computing is about understanding your emotions from your, well, bioindicators really, mostly, and seeing whether you can control computers from that. So you might be using techniques like, somebody heard of galvanic skin response? GSR? No? Okay, well, you've been learning about that, so there's things like galvanic skin response, heart rate, pupil dilation, which can all be used to understand emotional response to an interface or to a situation. Okay, there's a lot of work done on affective computing over at MIT and Rosalind McCall's group, and there's a lot, we're also doing quite a bit of work here on affective systems. Dynamic use. So we've got other kinds of use, such as, who's a gamer? Sure, computer science, there must be gamers. Okay, well, gamers, gamification, have you heard of gamification? Yes. Okay, so it's kind of adding gaming traits to standard pieces of software to make them either more interesting or more addictive. Okay, and the problem with, well, not the problem with this, is that there's a lot of discussion whether this is a good or bad thing in the world. Okay, there's a lot of discussion about whether it really works or not. Okay, so there was a number of games created to, for instance, there was a rubbish game, a trash game in New York and London. Did anybody hear about that? So generally, you've got rubbish cans that have sensors in them, and the more rubbish, no, recycling. That's right, recycling. The more recycling you do. The more recycling you do, the higher up the leaderboard. And so cities were pitted against each other, and they had this leaderboard to try and encourage recycling. Of course, it's a game, but it only lasts, it doesn't last that long. Okay? So we're going to look at that. Judgment without cessation. So generally here, everything you do is going to be a judgment. Everything that your employers will ask you for is going to be your judgment. If anything, being a user experience specialist is something that's going to mean that you are going to have to judge things, you're going to be asked to judge things and come up with an answer far more than anybody else in the software lifecycle. Okay? So they want, when people come, they want answers. And they're prepared to pay for it as well. So it's also a reasonably good specialism to get into. And then we look at prove yourself wrong. So the thing with prove yourself wrong is that we expect what you should be trying to do is not prove yourself right. That's easy. What you should be trying to do is prove yourself wrong. And they do it a lot in physics, they do it in chemistry, they do it a lot in lots of other scientific disciplines. We just don't do very much in computer science. Okay. Why don't we do much in computer science? It's going to be an interactive course, so what will happen is I'll start to pick on random people who you know, I feel like if maybe starts asking questions. So you might as well get used to it.
Well, we use it in the more logical sides of the course.
Yeah, more logical, theoretical sides, we do that, yeah. But
often we'll allow the compiler to do it for us.
True, but I think a lot of the time in computer science, the thing that we're interested in, it's more like engineering, because we're creating something. It's not so much discovery of something new in the world, it's building something, yes.
If you're building an app or a piece of software, sometimes it's good enough.
Yeah, we're not trying. That's right, and we're not trying to. You're trying to discover stuff in a lot of other things like physics. You're trying to discover something. Okay, you might have to manipulate sort of atoms or protons to do this, but you're still trying to discover something. Here in computer science, there's far less of that. We're far more trying to create something, build something. Just as a side issue, because I'm full of boring trivia. In the old days, 500 years ago, natural sciences, what were natural sciences? Does anybody know what natural science was?
Natural philosophy.
Natural philosophy, yeah. So natural philosophy, what was that all really?
Thinking about the world.
So it's a lot. So really it's called physics. Okay, so a lot of it is physics, natural philosophy, that kind of thing. It's physics, chemistry, that kind of stuff. But this stuff we call engineering now, this stuff that's creation, was called not engineering. What was it called? Any ideas?
Art.
Art. Exactly right. And so, the things that God created, the investigation of the things that God created, were called natural philosophy. Okay, natural sciences. The things that, and that's called science, the things that man created were called art. Okay? So, in reality, what you're doing in computer science mostly is art. Okay, in the terms 500 years ago, because you're creating stuff. Okay? The things that you're going to do now is you're going to do a bit of both. You're going to investigate what has been created by God, if you want, or nature in human intellect, okay? Cognitive, behavioural issues, psychology, and you're also going to be coupling that with things that we create. Okay? So that's where the kind of difference is. Now, don't panic. People were so panicked. We're not going to do this year. This was statistical analysis. Who's done statistical analysis before? Inferential description and descriptive statistical analysis. Who's heard of Mann, Whitney, Hughes, and Overs, and Wilcox, and. Yeah. Okay. Well, that's okay, because I'm looking for a really good way to teach this, and it's taken me 2 years or to get to try and find a really good way. You'll hear me ranting on. At that point, I rant for about 5 minutes about why people get a lot of statistical stuff wrong. I just can't help it. And then we just move on. So it's not examinable. Okay. And then IRL, in real life. Okay. So in real life part, we're not going to have a formal lecture, although there are notes. So it is examinable. There are notes. But this is where we're going to get the BBC in, and they're going to tell you what it's like in real life, as opposed to me just talking about it. Okay. Some of these also might slightly move around in the order in which we're going to do them. It's okay because they all can be studied as a single thing. Okay. So as I say, you shouldn't confuse this high-level overview with something that actually will allow you to suddenly straight go into an HCI role. Okay. People spend entire degrees and master's on this. But what it does do is two things. If you're going to be a software engineer or a technical person or a manager, any of those kind of people, then you'll need to be able to understand what an HCI person or a UX person can do for you. Yeah? And you'll need to understand the terminology they're using so that you can understand what they're talking to you about, okay, and why. If you want to get into this as a specialism, then this might be your first taste of it. And I know from last year's course we had a number of people who went off to do masters in HCI because that's what they wanted to do. I use the term HCI and UX in some cases interchangeably. There's a difference though between the two. So one of the main differences between HCI is that HCI is very thought of as being very quantitative and scientific. It involves measurements a lot. So for instance, task completion time, that's a good HCI thing. So generally, has anybody heard of Fitts' Law? Fitts' Law? Okay, well, you're going to. Okay, so in Fitts' Law, you've got a nice task completion time of how long it takes for somebody to point to an object on the screen with a mouse. Okay, and it's replicable. It happens for everybody. Okay, and that's a nice bit of HCI. User experience is far more maybe imperceptible, intangible. It's far more about an experience overall. So that with user experience, if the experience was good, but the task completion time was slow, it would still be positive. Whereas in HCI normally, or most HCI, task completion time beats experience. Okay, so that's kind of the difference. Here, I'm putting the two together because that's what I think it really is. It's kind of a mixture of both, and a lot of people agree with me. There's lots of this where it's really a mixture of both, so you should understand that. But we're also looking at the tangible and the intangible too. Okay. Tools, techniques, and mindset to do a user experience job for testing, okay, user testing. So you should know all of this by the time you finish. And if you don't know it all, that's okay because it's in your notes. That's why there's so much of them. Okay. You'll find that the notes are reasonably easy to read, I hope. If there's anything that you disagree with or you want to get back to me on, you should email me. Okay, so last year some people pointed to some nice gamification resources which are now in the notes, etc., etc. Yeah? So it's fine. It's an evolutive process to all this. Okay. Provide you with overall knowledge and a basis for future self-study. That's the main thing, it's a basis for future self-study as well. Okay, so origins. UX is a practical field of research knowledge repurposed from other domains into the user-based and software engineering process. So that's one of the things that I think it is, user experience. You might disagree with me after you've read the paper, and that's okay. And you can say you disagree with me in your 250 words, if you want. Okay? And your argument will be the thing it's marked on, not whether you're right. Okay? Or I am. Okay. It's very young, as I've said before, so it's a very young field. The reason why these notes, why we don't use any other user experience book is one, because you might as well understand Manchester's view of user experience, in that there is a view, because there has to be, but also accept the fact that there might be other competing views of what user experience is. If you read a normal UX book, well, there aren't any UX textbooks, but if you use a UX research text, then there's a very specific, this is what user experience is. Well, that's not very good for you, because you need to see, when you go into jobs, you need to understand what the other people are thinking UX is. And there's no shared understanding quite yet. All we know is that UX is a big software engineering thing. It's big in software engineering. So UX, it's great in software engineering. They use it all the time. What they use, people know what they use it. Okay, that's the idea. Notes from scratch, there's no set UI text. Although, who's read Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance? Yes. Yeah. Yeah? Zen and the Art of Maintenance? Anybody else? Anybody heard of Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance? Okay, well, that's good. So, you're going to be reading it, because that's the tool course text. Okay? So, Zen, and in your appendix, you'll find a critique of why I've set you Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance to what the book will bring to you. It's not examinable. Okay? I'm not going to ask you in-depth questions about sending the books. But it's an excellent book. It starts to get a bit stodgy around page 200, so you can stop there if you like. Okay. Coursework. All submissions go into Blackboard. 250 words. We check the length. Length matters to a 10% tolerance either way. It matters in the real world, it matters here. They go through Turnitin, you'll get a grading, you'll get feedback, it can be written, and you'll get that feedback back within 2 weeks. If there's any feedback that you are unsure about, you don't understand, you want to talk about, is there anything you want to talk about, you see me. Okay? So that's fine. Just come to see me anytime you want, really. Okay. Step-by-step submission instructions are on page 327, so it's all there. There's no exceptions. It's not a first-year lab. But in real life, there's no exceptions, and there's no exemptions. When your manager says, I want 250 words on my desk at 9:00 in the morning, that means he wants 250 words. He or she wants 250 words on their desk at 9:00 in the morning. Going to say, oh, I can't do it. The printer was busy, not going to work. The power goes off, or the computer explodes. I don't care. You've had enough notice, and neither will your manager. Okay. If your hamster dies in a horrible sea-choking accident, it doesn't matter. I'm very sorry for your loss. I'll help you dig the little hole. Or flush it. Who knows? You haven't got a dog. It can't chew your answers, and your answers are on the computer. This was an excuse I got one time in the database lecture. USB pen has not been abducted by aliens down Oxford Road. It might have been late, you might have been drunk, but you've lost it. There's no aliens. Well, you might be aliens, actually. Now, if you get hit by a bus, have a serious or gruesome chainsaw accident, very dangerous chainsaws, attacked by a loose buffer on Oxford Road, for instance, then I might be lenient. Okay, so if you've got a real excuse, then that's okay, you need to come and see me. preferably before you use the excuse. Okay? Otherwise, I just get annoyed. Okay? And I say, XYZ hasn't submitted again. Don't think I don't look at all of this stuff. I'm a control freak. Okay? Okay. Plagiarism, don't do it. You all know this. It's your third year. I don't suppose I need to tell you, but it's just something I wanted to anyway. You're all grown-ups. Plagiarism's no good. And it's going into Turnitin, which has plagiarism detector for both this year and last year. Okay, for all of this stuff. So cutting chunks out of research papers and Turnitin if you don't get the work either. Also, you'll see that in the appendices there is some page 333. It tells you there's instructions for teaching assistants. So the teaching assistants just get this. So you can see how it's going to be marked, because that's what I tell the teaching assistants, okay? So you know what they're going to mark it on. And you also say that on page 335 we have 5 exemplars. 6 exemplars. Okay, of the first one. Now these exemplars are actual students from last year who got the highest marks for this particular bit of work, 90% a lot. So, and I got their agreement to allow me to publish them as examples to you. If you cut and paste one of these, or take the text to get your 90%, the student goes, oh no, can't do that, so don't do it. Yeah? Okay, so those are the 8, so you've got exemplars if you want. I'm telling you all this now and kind of doing the kind of one of it so you can make your choices better for your options. Obviously, because you've still got a couple of things to change if you want. So you can still change if you want, so that's good. Okay, so this is the first one. A really excellent research paper published in ACM CHI, so Computer Human Interaction. You've probably heard of ACM CHI, it's a research conference. Biggest HCI conference there is. Okay, it's got the highest quality work. With an acceptance rate of about 12% for everything submitted. Okay. This is a really nice paper. So what these guys did is they had a survey of software engineers and user experience people to say what's the most important thing for you in user experience. What do you think user experience is? Because we can't say. We don't quite know. There's lots of different views. Try and get a shared conception. Okay. And so this kind of gives you an idea of a feeling of what UX is when you read it. Okay, so that's the first one. You can get this from the reference in your paper copies. Obviously, on the course website, there's a clickable link in the notes, because the notes are electronic too, so you can click the links if you want, or a PDF, and just get this. You need to be on university property, or through it needs to go through some kind of university system for you to be able to download the paper, otherwise you have to pay for it. Yeah? As with most research. Okay, so B is a university computer before you print it. The next one is designing the STAR user interface. So has anybody heard of STAR? Anybody heard of Xerox? Anybody heard of Xerox PARC? Who's heard of Xerox? Who's heard of Xerox PARC? Okay, cool. Xerox PARC was one of the best, in fact I would venture to say the best, place for building software back in the day. Okay? Lots and lots of excellent, excellent work was done there, really high quality stuff. Okay, it still exists, but Park isn't now. It's a research establishment not owned by Xerox. Anyway, they created a user interface called the STAR user interface, and this is the user interface that all you pretty much use still, unchanged. It was taken by Apple. So we all think, oh, Apple created this thing, there's Windows. Microsoft went along and kind of made Windows out of Apple's GUI. But the reality is that Apple went to see, or Jobs went to see, the STAR interface and thought, this is great, and we started in Apple. Okay? all the stuff you do now, things like desktops, Xerox, folders, Xerox, okay? All this standard stuff, all invented there. And this is seminal paper, okay? 10 marks. And voice loops as control interface for space shuttle mission control, okay? So, we talk about user X and HCI, and I'm telling you, and you're probably thinking about it in kind of apps and that kind of thing, or, you know, sort of web apps, mobile apps, stuff that you're maybe building as a standard bit of software for a company. But reality is it also is very, very, very important in safety-critical software. Okay? Very important in safety-critical stuff. So if you get people who press the wrong buttons in a safety-critical situation because they're confused about the interface, then things go terribly wrong. Okay? We can see that in various plane crashes, where people didn't understand what was going on because the interface was too complicated. It also didn't fit into their conception of what they should be doing if you're a pilot, and because the pilots weren't asked very much. And so it's responsible, bad interface responsible for the deaths of thousands of lives in safety critical systems. In fact, there's actually quite an interesting story whereby nuclear power plants, a couple of the nuclear power plants that were designed the same in California, there was three large levers and nothing to distinguish what those levers were to do. So the actual users there, the technicians, changed them and made them into earphones so they could actually recognise what was what, because one ejected the nuclear material when the pressure got too high. So, but it's right next to the one that doesn't. So pull the wrong one, it all goes wrong. Logically, they fit together because they're at a control station. But mentally, they don't. Conceptually, they don't. Okay. Attacks, as I said, this is here, up 10:30, so if you go to Motorcycle Maintenance, you can get this free copy. It was free, everyone's saying that. There's a free copy in the notes, if you want to read it from online. You can just search for it as well, I think it's over at Caltech, actually. They've OCR'd it. But there we are, so you can have a look at their kind of OCR of this if you don't want to actually get the book. Assessment structure. How are you going to be assessed? We might as well talk about that now. So, 30 marks for the assessment, 10 marks for each, 70 marks for your exam. Your exam is going to be 1 hour 30 minutes, I think it says, 1 hour 30 minutes long, so two parts. The first part is compulsory and comprises 10 multiple choice questions. The second part, you choose from two more descriptive questions. Okay? Last year's exam is open and available, and you should be able to get it if you want to get it, so that you can see it's in the normal exam archive. I have a question bank of 100 questions, and I have a random number generator, obviously not completely random, but a random number generator, let's say, which chooses numbers between 1 and 100. Those are the questions you get for this exam, for whatever exam. So I don't have a control over what questions you get, apart from I write them. The self-assessment questions prove to be pretty good indicators of the kind of questions you're going to get. Okay? So if you can do the self-assessment questions at the end of each chapter, you're likely to be able to do the exam. Yeah? Those aren't the same questions, but there's a high coupling between them. Okay? Top of the screen. So, the kind of things. A multiple choice question. Obviously, you're not going to be doing this kind of thing here, but a multiple choice question isn't kind of a general easy thing that you might think it is. So these multiple choice questions, you have a little bit of text at the top, and from your knowledge, you choose which is the best to use. So would you choose for this question, would you choose a chi-square, a t-test, a one-way ANOVA, a repeated measured ANOVA, or a man with the EU? So bookwork type question, we're all expecting you to just give me a definition. By the way, when we say bookwork, etc., all these terms, concepts are based on Bloom's taxonomy. Does anyone know Bloom's taxonomy? Bloom's taxonomy. No? It's a way of understanding people's learning styles and what kind of questions to test people at different stages. Okay. And so all the questions are written to Bloom's taxonomy. So in each of these one example, in each of the questions with subparts in it of part two, the sub questions, and each of them ties into these Bloom's taxonomy. So you'll get, you're bound to get a booklet question. One of them, so for instance, a bookmark question might be, what do we mean by internal and external validity? Okay, well, I'm not expecting nervous now, I'm just trying to give you some idea about the kind of questions. What is the scientific method of measuring improvement? Okay, straightforward. Discussion type questions, how does UX relate to standard software engineering? Requirements analysis. Who's done requirements analysis in software engineering? Surely, who's done the software engineering course? You still all do requirements analysis, right? Okay, so how does it relate to, say, requirements analysis? You'll get to know this in these notes, so there's pretty standard. If you're 100% correct answers in UX, how do you decide what is right and what is wrong? Oh, that's a question somebody could be expecting. Go on, anybody know that one? I've given the answer in the audio. Yeah.
Because of the feedback from potential market audience.
Okay, something a little bit different, a little bit more.
Do you want to do it? Do you want to do it?
It works.
Yeah, you just take what it
works. Well, how do you know what works?
You just as long as you valid arguments, what you have to say.
Valid arguments? Anything else? Statistical analysis? Maybe? We can see to you within a 0.5% confidence interval there, and 0.01. Yeah? So statistical analysis is often the way to do it. Okay. List of 6 UX errors in criminality. So that's another one. That's application of technique, as an example. Or you've been tasked with providing your company's software, proving that your software is immediately learnable. You don't need to have any teaching for it. Design experiments and discuss any issues described by the other online tools. Experimental design is a key part of what you're doing. Yeah? So that's another thing. You need to be able to design an experiment. Okay, and things like engineering thought. So this is the final kind of Bloom's taxonomy. Can you put together the things I've been teaching you into an original, when asked a question you haven't actually been trained to answer? What is quality? Define and discuss. And explain why you have come to this view and how it works from your experience. Of 49 medical articles, 45 claim to have uncovered effective interventions. 34 of these claim to have been retested, and 14 of these, or 41%, have been convincingly shown to be wrong. Okay? So 14 of the 49 are wrong. Between a third and a half of the most acclaimed research you mentioned seems to be untrustworthy. Is this a problem? No, well, I say no, but hang on. Okay, but why would I say no? That's up to you to decide. Okay. Expectations. Now, it's a little bit quiet this time. When you go and then you come back, it'll get a little bit more less quiet, I hope. Primary expectation is for you to interact with me. That's how you're going to have a little experience. Otherwise, you know, just sitting there reading the newspaper, what can you do? You know, it's not going to have the learning experience that you guys need. Okay. Anybody interested will be able to understand and pass this course. Anybody committed will be able to do the exam and the coursework. It's not, there's information to understand, but I don't expect memorisation. I expect your brains to be working more than anything. Yeah. I'm here to help. Okay? I'm here to give feedback. Problems with the course itself. Work you're expected to do. Problems in general, not just course related, and not just related to this course. Need more feedback? Anything else you're not clear about, you talk to me. All of it, your entire experience in here, not just in this lecture, but anything else, you can talk to me. Yeah? Any extra feedback you want, feedback you're not getting, with any other lectures, or anything else, you can talk to me. Okay. Come to me at the end of the lecture, or you can talk privately. My surgery hours, where I call them, are Friday afternoons from 4 till 6. 7 o'clock, I'll be in the corner. So, yeah? 8 o'clock, the answer will be completely incoherent. Now, If you do not feel comfortable talking to me, maybe because I've got a problem with my teaching style, and I'm terrible, evil, evil to a specific people, I'm a bad man. Okay. Any of those reasons, talk to somebody else in confidence. You should, if you have any problems with this talk you don't have to tell me about, talk to... Rob, who should you talk to? Who's the first port of call if this course is terrible? Or I'm terrible? Or it's all terrible? Who's the first port of call that's not me?
Tim.
Tim Morris is the first port of call. And if you get to Tim Morris, he's a nice guy, he'll help you out. But just to say, he can't, because for some other reason he can't that time. Who's the next port of call? Toby Howard, Director of Undergraduate Studies, that's what you do. And if Toby can't help because, you know, we can't, and we'll be here, oh, terrible. Who's the next port of call?
You're on your own.
No. Never on your own here. Jim Miles, the head of school. Okay, so, any problems, you progress it up the tree. I do not mind going to anybody else that's not me and talking about this lecture or my teaching style or anything else. Okay? There's too much work, there's too little work, it's not challenging enough, there's too blah, blah, blah. Okay? It's fine. Take it to your student reps, take it to the other people at the tree so we can change something if you don't want to speak to me about it. Okay? That's good. Alright. Coffee time. Back at 3 minutes past 12, don't be late. If you decide that you don't want to do this course, you don't need to come back. And if you haven't got notes for this course, there's some of the first things you have to do at the bottom. If you want to talk to me about it,
I'm
Say that in the work. He can say it, but he didn't really. Okay? Okay, that's the first thing. But why? Why is it that people have latched onto this and they say now 5 users can get 80%? Why is it that over 10 to 15 years this has now become seemingly reality, truth? Exactly right, because it's much cheaper. Usability tests are really expensive, so if you're a standard commercial company and you want to have 6 users in and they look at a piece of software for half an hour to an hour over the space of a day, that's going to cost you £6,000 a day. If you're a company. So one day is better than reality. Okay? Now, we did some other work, or there was some other work done, which shows that this isn't actually the case, because all they did is Faulkner. She looked around lots of different kinds of usability tests to see how many bugs there were, and then she's done a good empirical study of them. Okay? Sets for 5 users is here at the top, on the top right. And you can see it's speckled all over the place. Sets for 10 users you get better, 15 you get better, and 20 is really what it takes to get 19%. You can do it with 15 possibly. Okay. Now there's even more statistical work that says that this all depends on lots of other competing factors. These competing factors are called confounding variables in psychology, and that's what you guys are going to be. Has anybody heard of confounding variables before? One? Yeah, okay. So this is something that we say a lot in HCI. They're confounding variables. They're real world variables we can't account for. Okay, and they happen a lot. So that's why we can never be 100% confident. Because there's a confounding variable we might not have thought of. Anyway. So there's other work that's in the notes that says that you need maybe even 15 users. Okay, it needs to be worked out statistically. Okay? So it's not an easy answer, even though this is something that most usability people say, yeah, this is right. Okay? So when you get into your companies, somebody says this, we only find users, tell them where they're wrong. Okay, the moon orbits the Earth. How likely do you think this is to be correct? This is an example of, if I tell you, this is an example of shorthand. What will that do you? Will that do any good? The moon orbits the Earth. It's an example of shorthand.
Well, they both orbit each other. They orbit a point between them.
Exactly right. What they actually do is the moon orbits the combined centre of gravity of the Earth and the moon. Those are the main effects. Obviously, gravity in general has an effect through the universe, but in this case, it's the main effect is on the centre of gravity of them both, and it just so happens it's very close to the centre of the Earth, but it isn't exactly. Okay, so we say, oh, the moon rotates around the Earth. Well, kind of, yes, but also not. So these kind of shorthands are things that are used a lot in software engineering, a lot in interface design, but they're not exactly accurate. And knowing that they're not exactly accurate is a good thing to do. To question their accuracy is always useful, because that means that a fact that you might need to use becomes available to you. Yeah? Blind people can't see. How likely do you think that is? People who are registered blind can't see. Kind of obvious, isn't it? No?
Because you can be legally blind and they can still have some sight.
That's right. So you can be legally blind, but you can still have some sight. So the World Health Organization defines this as being able to distinguish 3 fingers at 5 feet. Okay? About that. So if you can't do that, then you can be legally blind. Okay? So therefore, a very small number of people who are blind, legally blind, can't see anything, but what's called profoundly blind. Okay, very small number. On the blind population, everybody reads Braille, don't they?
Yeah.
No. They don't. Very few people read Braille. It's mostly audio, and actually, an even better language is called Moon. Okay, so Moon was something that's got far more traction than Braille. But we all think, oh, Braille for the blind people, that's the way it goes. Yeah? Most people don't know. All brains have the same organisation. How likely do you think that's to be true? All of our brains are pretty much the same. I think it's kind of obvious because we're all in the same room. It's not. So generally, there's a thing called neuroplasticity. Has anybody heard of neuroplasticity? Okay, good. So neuroplasticity is whereby your brain is developing up to say the age of 21, and different parts of your brain, if they're not used, are repurposed for other things. So for instance, if you are blind, then your visual cortex, and you're blind up before the age of 21, based on when that is, if you go blind before that age, then your visual cortex is repurposed for auditory and tactile. So it's not the same. So people's brains are often not the same at all, even though people would like us to think they are. So the visual cortex, in some regard, doesn't necessarily exist in some concepts of neurophysiology. Okay? So even though you think these things are right, and people would teach you that they're right, and I could put a great big picture on the board and say, oh, that's the visual cortex, in fact, I'll be doing that to some point in the course. Okay, and this is the visual cortex, and this is the Sylvian fissure, and this is the frontal lobe, blah, blah, blah. Those necessarily aren't the case. The general organisation and layout of the lobes are, because they're generally defined by us. Okay, so those are generally about right. But what the use is not the same. Okay, repurposed for different stuff. How do we know that? How do we know this? How do you know? Well, in fact, you should be questioning, you should be saying, Simon, but you're talking crap. How do you know this?
You do experiments with MRI machines, for example.
Absolutely right. MRI machines are a functional that so you can see what's going on. fMRI scans are the best one, the better ones. We can do it with PET scans, you can look at blood flow, and in extreme cases, you could do it with something called eventulated potential, okay, which is something that sits on the outside of the skull.
Yeah, is that the one that zaps you and messes up the electricity while you play computer games?
Yeah. Okay. Vision is parallel. Hearing is serial. That's often what people think. We can, you know, when we're looking at stuff, we can see all this great big thing. It's all, you know, we can see all in 3D. But hearing is just one. It's just one sound wave going into your ear, and that's that. How likely do you think that's to be correct?
Then we have different hair, but then different frequency.
Absolutely right. Yeah. And that's on the basal membrane, okay? So you've got these little hairs that sense different kinds. It's like a bit like a graphic equalizer. As the sound wave progresses up to the apex, okay? So you've got the base and the apex, and you progress up there, and you get a certain stiffness on the basal membrane, and that stiffness means that you get different sensors. And also, you get different neurons firing, so different neurons are connected to different parts of the brain. So the brain also is sectioned in the auditory cortex for different frequencies. Okay? So in reality, that's not the case. We also can see, you also might be saying to me, well, yes, but that might be the case, but still there's only one serial wave going in, surely. How likely is that to be true, knowing what I'm sure you know about Fourier addition? Anybody know anything about Fourier addition? Okay, so you get multiple waves that combine. Okay, so therefore that's where you can hear things from lots of different spatial dimensions. Other aspects that might not be 3D. they might not be just directly audio that mean that we can hear things why is our hearing just not serial in that case? If it's not just about the sound wave going into our ears.
Well, you can tell where the sound comes from.
Tell where the sound comes from. How do you think you can do that?
You've got ears on both sides of your head. You've got these complicated things that change the shape of the sound as it comes in.
One more thing that you don't get from, say for instance, surround sound headsets. You don't get this from surround sound headsets, and it's kind of missed out. One other thing.
You can hear the vibration through things that aren't your ear.
Yep, skull. It's called the skull effect. So you can hear, you can sense sound, and you can see, you can hear sound, and you get the vibration through the skull. And that's called skull effect. Okay, so you can sort of locate your hands a bit better. Okay. This. Has anybody seen this?
Yes.
Well, sure. Let's see if I can find it. This thing work. Don't be.
This is a test of selective attention.
Yes, it is.
Can count how many times the players wearing white pass the basketball. How many passes did you count? The correct answer is 15 passes. But did you see the gorilla?
So who didn't see the gorilla? Who didn't see the gorilla? Yeah. So when you look at it, it's very easy to see, right?
This video is from research by Daniel Simons and Christopher Chabri, and is.
Okay, so that's an example of what's called attention blindness. Okay, so generally, when you're cognitive, you're looking, you're doing something, you're trying to count something, or you know, you're focused in a certain position. Oftentimes, for a high percentage, it's around 60%. I mean, it varies. People have different variations of this, but 60-70% of the population don't see the drill. Maybe more in some cases. You guys are kind of key to it because people are laughing when they see it because they've seen it before and stuff like that. But generally, that's the amount. So lots of people suffer with this. They're directed to something and they don't see anything around. It's kind of a tunnel vision thing. Yeah. So it's really interesting to see this attention blindness and how attention blindness works in lots of things. You know, people get hit by buses because they don't see the bus. Not for any reason, they can't see the bus, just it's not there to them. They don't see it. Okay, it doesn't register. And that's something you need to think about. Just because you display something to people, doesn't mean they're going to see it. Doesn't mean to say even if it's there flashing, they're going to see it if their attention is on something else. So this kind of attention, idea of attention, is really big in HCI. It's really big in psychology, but it's also really big in HCI and computer science. Okay. And so when you're doing your kind of work, you're going to have to think to yourself, oh, where am I placing attention? Okay. Where's the locus of attention for this particular user, for this particular person? How is it going to fit together? And this is one of the things that people, you know, some people say, oh, well, Ted Nelson maybe, these things, you know, you see this image, and you didn't see the bear, the gorilla, but actually it's there, so you're wrong. Okay. There's been moonwalking, I mean, people have done this on lots of other stuff. Actual real basketball games without a moonwalking bear. And people just don't notice the moonwalking bears because they're not focused on it. You know, it's really crazy stuff. There's lots of other examples of this, and if you want to Google YouTube, you'll see these kind of, you know, if you look at for attention blindness or these kind of, you know, gorilla or that kind of thing, you get lots of different examples of how this kind of stuff. It's quite interesting to see what people do and don't look at. Yeah? Okay, so this is one thing, the thing that comes out of this bit. Is the fact that I want you to be curious and I want you to be critical. Okay? This is what you should take away from this part. The things that you think are right may be wrong. The things that you were taught are right may be wrong. The things I'm telling you may be wrong. That's why you should ask me to support what I'm saying. Okay? The things that I'm saying may be shorthand for something, which you don't, the things that you believe might be shorthand for something. There might be very good reasons why human cognition and human visual attention doesn't work as you expect it to work, just as we've seen with the bear, gorilla. Okay? So you should always be curious, always be critical, and don't take what anybody says as being completely truthful. You should allow it to be supported in evidence, in the evidence base. You get lots of people making, I mean, it's terrible in politics. You know, the nuanced arguments of politics mean that there's a lot more than non-nuanced arguments in politics. It's just crazy. There's so much left out so that they can get a psychological effect from the user. Now here, Coca-Cola, here's one example, invested a huge amount of money in Coke trials. Okay? They wanted a new formula because the new formula is cheaper. Blah, blah, blah. Or we wanted to make it taste better, yeah, whatever. Okay? Super. UK could be a big success, lots of consumer research, taste tested, thousands of customers, clearly shown that these people preferred it, but nobody bought it. And in fact, These people, there's lots of people who got this new, in fact, when I was in Iowa, they go on trips to Mexico because they can get original Coke. And they come back with great big trucks full of original Coke because nobody likes this new stuff. Okay? Because it's cheaper. The original one is made with corn syrup, I think, and it makes it taste much easier. Okay, but the new formula was cheaper, but it didn't like it. Yeah. Probably what people said that they really loved it. They had to change the formula back. Not back, but to a different one that wasn't, that was slightly more palatable. So why do people say that we love it when obviously they didn't?
Because it was free.
Because
it was free.
Because it was free, okay, but they were getting two different types. At the, on the taste test, there was, oh, have this one, have this one, have this one, and they chose a particular one. So they were all free for free. So you and you.
Did they know the difference between the two when they were testing? I guess not. Then maybe they just didn't want to disappoint anyone. It's like, yeah, it's all great. I love it all.
Okay, that's one answer, yeah.
Maybe they've been told that it's the same group.
Improved, yeah, that might be another one. Okay,
I was going to suggest that if they knew there was a new Coke and they were trying the new Coke, they'd be inclined to suggest that it was better because it's an evolved version of the old Coke.
Yeah, that's another good nuance, yes.
When they're expecting to drink Coke, they want to drink what they know.
They want to drink what they know, yeah, okay.
It's the same as what Elizabeth said. Double blind tests are really hard to do.
Yeah.
And if you don't do them properly, then you get rush results.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Was the user demographic varied enough? Were all mid-age men doing testing or women?
Yeah, that's true. That's very true. Yeah.
There's a fact I can't remember school, but where like the test become makes people change their behaviour just because they know that they're doing the test rather than.
Another one. Good one. Any more?
I don't think it matters what test they did, because when they launched the product, it was different from the original Coke can, which everyone was very up in the light, so they weren't inclined to buy it.
Okay, yeah, that's another answer. So, what they found actually is one of the main problems with this is the way that the experiment was conducted. The experimental design was incorrect because, as you say, and as has been intimated by lots of people here, that the experimenters were sat right there, and the three blinded Coke cans. Couldn't see either of them, three different cans, which one do you like? The what but the experimenter knew the can. So the experimenter was, that's the one, kind of. So you can see body language based on the fact that this is the one that they should be choosing. And so they chose the one that they thought the body language of the experimenter was, was that the experimenter wanted. And that's called experimental effect. Okay? So you have to watch out for experimental effects. In this kind of way, that you can influence it. So